Ladies and gentlemen, the President of the United States and Mrs. Reagan. Ladies and gentlemen, the national anthems of the Hussein Kingdom of Jordan and the United States of America.
It is a distinct pleasure and an honor to welcome your majesties to Washington. I've been looking forward to meeting King Hussein longer than I've been president. One of the advantages of age is the perspective it gives to looking back. I've watched King Hussein for a distance for many years, watched as he ascended the throne and accepted great responsibility while still in his teens. And in the years since, he's proved himself time and again a brave man and, I might add, a wise leader. Our friendship with King Hussein has stood the test of time. It's based on shared interests, but also on common values and mutual respect. During the 3 decades that he has led Jordan, America has maintained an unwavering dedication to the search for Middle East peace. Over these many years, King Hussein has been our friend. His loyalty is not lightly regarded by the people of the United States. Let it be understood that America seeks peace with honor and security for all the states and people of the region. Undoubtedly, a similar goal to your own. At this moment, Your Majesty, there's much to discuss about how to reach our mutual goal. Recent tragic events make it even more imperative that we work together if solutions are to be found. Today, let us achieve an understanding about ourselves and then reaffirm to the world that there are no differences between us that we cannot overcome, and that will lessen the friendship between the United States and the United Kingdom of Jordan. For our part, no one should doubt that the preservation of Jordan's security, integrity, and its unique and enduring character remains a matter of highest importance. Your Majesty, over the years, your concern for the well-being of your people, your creative statesmanship, and your good sense have enriched Jordan. Under your leadership, King Hussein, the Jordanian economy has yielded fruit literally and figuratively to all the citizens of Jordan. And in Jordan today, the private sector is thriving and the standard of living is increasing, a model for developing nations. In the last 2 decades, the literacy rate rose from 32% to 70%. Educated Jordanians now fill skilled jobs all over the Middle East. Meanwhile, unemployment has almost disappeared and Jordan boasts an average annual economic growth rate of 9%. Your success offers hope that people who've known previous adversity can rise above their conflicts to build a new life. Similarly, there are tremendous opportunities for economic betterment in your region while political problems work themselves out. Given freedom to do so, people who live in such proximity will interact to better themselves even though divided by politics. Such peaceful interaction should be applauded. Furthermore, the United States encourages any mutually beneficial economic cooperation between nations. The problems of water and transportation, for example, are areas of potential benefit to you and your neighbors if a far-sighted approach is taken. Your Majesty, there are, however, other forces which seek to widen and exploit the divisions among the peoples of the Middle East. Tension and conflict both reflect and increase the power and influence of such hateful forces. When focusing on the internal problems of the region, we must never lose sight of the role of external powers in aggravating those problems. In your book, Uneasy Lies the Head, you proclaimed, "I fear only God." Well, in your life, you've demonstrated courage in so many ways. As a pilot, as a soldier, and most important, as a statesman. But the point of that statement is not alone that you're brave, but that you are devout. It highlights your belief in and respect for the supreme being who is the mother of us all. Americans admire such values. Years ago, your grandfather, King Abdullah, in his memoirs, wrote, "It is the duty of all Arabs to bear witness to the world that they possess a place and constitute an entity among the nations of the world, and that they stand today at the side of the democracies in the contest between fear-inspiring communism and popular democracy." Your Majesty, during your reign, you have demonstrated the wisdom of your grandfather by maintaining a perspective on the potential danger providing leadership in the issues confronting you and your neighbors. The United States is concerned about settlements to the Middle East, as well as those issues which most directly affect the people of the Middle East. We are sincerely attempting to do all that can be done to end the ongoing tragedy that has plagued that area of the world. Lasting peace is in our interest, as it is in the interest of all people of goodwill. Respecting our differences and knowing you as we do, we are confident that you share our heartfelt desire for peace and stability. Your courage and integrity earned this trust and respect long ago. The story is told that early in the rain, you decided to stay the night at a Bedouin encampment, which was under threat of attack. And while walking in the darkness, you heard the voice of an elder tribesman proclaim from inside a tent, Abdullah would be proud of his grandson. But we think that's even for today, and we want you to know that we too are proud of you as a friend.
It's indeed a moment for me. I express my sincere gratitude
for your warm welcome
to both you and myself and to our two colleagues who are with us today. It is a pleasure for us to be once again in the United States of America in response to your kind invitation. Visit with you, the leader of this great nation. This year, indeed, marks the 25th anniversary of a unique relationship between the United States and Poland, in its length and durability. It is a relationship seasoned by time and trouble. As the leader of Jordan 25 years ago, that the values and principles on which your nation's foundations were created were the same ones which are so dear to the Arabs and which were the foundations of the Arab awakening and resolve from the beginnings of this century. Was my commitment to those ideals and principles that prompted me to proudly seek the establishment and consolidation of a friendship between our nations a quarter of a century ago. Meaningful and dynamic relations must always be based on mutual understanding. These eventful years have been totally committed to both the cause of the Arab people, which is my cause and motivation, and to a realization that it is an honorable and just cause. I deemed it my duty to present it and defend it and explain it to the best of my ability. I am a firm believer in the proverb that lies and hide the truth from all the people half the time, half the people all the time, but not all of the people all the time, and that justice must inevitably prevail. We must not permit the distortions of others become a belief to the understanding on which our relationship is based. I know you, Mr. President, to be a man of honor, dedicated to the highest of ideals and principles. I know also that you have the courage of your convictions. You have displayed this throughout your public life, and because of it, have the respect of those who know you. I am confident that working together, all who truly seek peace and security for the people of the Middle East, and these qualities will be the source of strength which that goal requires. At this most turbulent and critical of times, I see in jeopardy not only Arab rights and legitimate interests, but a threat to the very Arab identity and the rights of future Arab generations. I also see the larger threats to world peace, as well as to the vital interests of all those concerned with the security of our region, including the United States of America. I hope that at this time I shall be able to present our case convincingly. In the interest of us all, and thus achieve greater mutual understanding. In doing so, we can pave the way towards formulating proper policies and build once more lasting and strengthened relations between us based on clear and solid foundations. It's a great task and a great challenge. It is indeed a duty. Despite the difficulties that surround us at this most critical juncture, I am optimistic and I am determined. I am hopeful that upon my return home, I shall be able to carry to my people and to my colleagues at the next Arab summit promising impressions and favorable news. I can but do my best in these coming days. For what is at stake, of course, of our national interests and the future of so many. I am confident that on the basis of our long, close friendship, and with courage, dedication, and God's blessing, we can, and indeed must, successfully meet the challenge before us. Mr. President, deeply in your debt for your friendship and the warmth of your welcome. May God bless you, protect you, guide your steps in leading the great American people towards a brighter future and in serving the cause of all mankind. Thank you.